Gospel according to Matthew. The 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had ordered them. When they saw him, they worshipped, but they doubted. Then Jesus approached and said to them, "All power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always until the end of the age." The Gospel of the Lord. Picture on the cover of our local Green Bay paper. On the cover of the Press Gazette was our college president, dressed in full business suit and tie, suspended in the air, upside down, just as he was about to plunge into the pool at the newly dedicated and blessed athletic center on the college campus. The photographer caught President Kunkel just before his hands broke the surface of the water. Like all photographs, this image was frozen in time. As we gather today to celebrate the Feast of the Ascension, we might imagine ourselves frozen in time, standing as disciples on the Mount of Olives, watching the risen Christ ascend to the Father. If a photographer were there to capture that moment, the camera lens would likely focus on our heads, tilted to the side and looking up toward the heavens. As we stand gazing toward the heavens, trying to capture one final glimpse of the risen and now ascending Christ, we find ourselves in the midst of a contemplative moment, heads tilted, gazing towards the sky, we stand watching as the risen Christ was lifted up and taken away by a cloud. Yet as we look intently toward the sky, suddenly our gaze is interrupted by a question from two heavenly messengers. Two men dressed in white interrupt our contemplation, asking us, "Men of Galilee, men and women of Depeer, why are you standing there looking up at the sky?" This question is startling. It startles us, but it's exactly what we need to hear. It's exactly what we need to hear for two reasons. First, it calls our gaze from the heavens back down to earth. This startling question invites us to remember the words we just heard spoken from the risen Christ. "And behold, I am with you always until the end of the age." For Christ has most certainly ascended to the Father, and in doing so, he remains with us now more than ever. He remains with us in and through the beauty of creation. He remains with us in word and sacrament. He remains with us in our blessedness and our brokenness. He remains with us in his advocate, the Spirit, whom he has sent to dwell among us. Secondly, this question from the heavenly messengers reminds us, get your heads out of the clouds. There's work to be done. Sounds like my mother again. Yet, if you are like me, initially, we may feel the need to resist this reality. We may want to linger here for a moment longer. Linger here just a moment longer to feel as intimately connected to our risen Lord. We may think, what do you mean? Why are you standing here looking at the sky? We're standing here looking at the sky because once again, we're bewildered. We're bewildered because this Jesus with whom we have witnessed so many good words and deeds once again seems to have been taken away from us. We are staring at the sky because for a moment, we don't know what the future has in store for us. Like the picture of President Kunkel frozen above the water, we stand on this mountainside frozen, frozen in time as the reality of the task that lies before us begins to cascade over us. As the heavenly messengers startle us out of this moment of contemplation, we recall the words of the risen Christ. After assuring us of his presence among us, the risen Christ commissioned all of us as his fellow disciples, as the mystical body of Christ, speaking these words to each of us. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. You will be my witnesses in Green Bay, throughout Illinois and Indiana and Washington and California, and to the ends of the earth. By virtue of our baptism, Christ speaks these words to all of us. Drawn out of this moment of contemplation, we recognize that we are not only men and women of contemplation, we are also women and men of action. The angel's startling question reminds us that we have been called and sent by the risen Christ. We have been sent to teach all that he has commanded us. What has he commanded us? Above all else, he has commanded us to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our soul, with all our bunch of those things, with all our soul and with all our strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. So how do we love God and love neighbor in a world that bombards us with so much rejection of God's unconditional love? Well, first, we can't stay on the mountaintop gazing into the heavens. We can't remain hidden inside this beautiful and joyful space. For there is work to be done. We have a message of faith, hope, and love to share with the world. Although we know we will go forth and encounter a world that is often darkened by division, divisive rhetoric, and downright evil, we are emboldened by the risen Christ, whose triumph over death has clearly shown us evil cannot nullify our desire to open up to the good. Suffering cannot overcome our willingness to share our compassion with our most vulnerable sisters and brothers. Christ has sent us forth to love God and love neighbor, to share his love that dwells within the depth of our hearts. Now you might be thinking, sure, these are beautiful words, but I'm not Pope Francis. I'm not Mother Teresa of Calcutta. I'm not even a newly ordained priest. You're right, you're not. But we are all precious, each and every one of us. Each and every one of us is irreplaceable in the eyes of God. Through the darkness and brokenness of our shared journeys, each and every one of us can become a bright candle, a reminder that light will always overcome darkness and never the other way around. As we come down from the Mount of Olives, as we emerge from inside this Abbey Church, we can be certain that the future has a name, and the name of the future is hope. Feeling hopeful does not mean to be optimistically naive and ignore the tragedy humanity faces every day. Hope is a virtue of the heart. Hope of the risen Christ doesn't lock itself into darkness. Hope doesn't dwell in the past. Hope does not simply get by in the present. And the hope of the risen Christ is able to see a tomorrow. Hope is a way into the future. Hope is a humble, hidden seed of life that with time will develop into a large tree. It is like some invisible yeast that allows the whole dough to grow, that brings flavor to all aspects of life. And with the hope of Christ, we can do so much, because a tiny flicker of light that feeds on hope is enough to shatter the shield of darkness. A single individual is enough for hope to exist. That individual can be you. And then there will be another you, and another you, and slowly this turns into an us. And slowly, as us, we begin to recognize that as a community of yous, we are not really a bunch of individuals. Rather, we recognize that we are one body of Christ. This body of Christ who gathers here today at St. Norbert Abbey, the same body of Christ gathers throughout the world. This body gathers to be nourished, nourished by the body and blood of Christ. Nourished and emboldened, we go forth today as the body of Christ. We go forth as witnesses, witnesses who teach by word and example that God loves us and that his infinite love inspires us to love God and love neighbor in and through all of our words and actions.